So let's start the sessions. Please find your seat. The next talk is on e-payments, PKI for banking transactions, opportunities and challenges by Dr. N.P. Dhavale, Deputy General Manager in the IDRBT, who is a fellow of the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. He has a doctorate in management with specialization in MIS and finance. He is an M.Tech from IIT Madras and B.E. Computer Engineering from University of Bombay. Prior to becoming a doctoral fellow at IIM Calcutta from 1995 to 2000, he was a deputy manager in avionics division of Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Hyderabad for 7 years. He has visited Curtin University of Technology, Perth, Western Australia during August to November 1999 under the Visiting Research Fellowship Program of IIM Calcutta and Curtin University. His research interests include intelligent agents, artificial intelligence, expert systems, and decision support systems. Over to Dhavale ji. Yeah. Welcome, sir.
So, good morning to everybody. Yeah, fine. I want to tell something about IDRBT certifying authority, and as IDRBT, we are actually in a unique situation. IDRBT is a producer and consumer both of the digital certificate. So we actually are in a situation which I don't think anybody else will be there. Either you are the regulator, so you are the CCA, or you are a bank, you are making use of certificates, or you are a certifying authority, you are issuing certificates, or maybe you are a relying party wherein a transaction has been done and you are just relying on a digital certificate. But here at IDRBT, see, we became a certifying authority in 2002. So last 14 years, we have been working as generators of the digital certificates. At the same time, we are the prime users of the digital certificate. So the challenges that the users face, we also face as IDRBT. Many of you may be aware, many of the bankers I see here, IDRBT certifying authority issues certificates for RBI's payment system application. And this is the exclusive issuer for such certificates. So other certifying authorities do not issue certificates for RBI's payment system applications. As a matter of fact, till 2005, when there were no e-governance applications which were making use of digital certificates, almost 100% of the certificates that were issued in India were issued by IDRBT only. Of course, subsequently the MCA came, then the income tax came, and then the scene totally changed. Most of you are from the PKI space and all, but banks are also here. So those of you who may not be knowing, IDRBT, in addition to being a certifying authority, we do many other things which are directly result of use of digital certificates which are generated by certifying authorities. We run what is called as structured financial messaging system. This is a messaging platform on which the systemically important payment system applications of the Reserve Bank, such as NEFT, RTGS, work. And I'm sure the subsequently when the speakers from the banks and from the central bank come, they will tell you more about it in terms of volumes, in terms of criticality and all. But I may just mention here that if you look at RTGS, daily transactions are a few lakh crore rupees. If you look at NEFT, I remember about 2 months back, we celebrated 30 million transactions. Actually, it was 30 million messages, and a message may contain up to 10 transactions. So you can understand the sizing requirements of the applications which are using the digital signature certificates. As I told, IDRBT is a service provider in terms of generation of certificates. IDRBT is actual user of these certificates because we run applications for the payment system application messaging platform. We have implemented a few solutions which are working in the payment system space. And we are partners to those who run other payment system applications. Examples are the Reserve Bank, Clearing Corporation of India, or Payment System Corporation, who work closely together to implement this payment system applications with complete authenticity using the digital signature certificate. And we need to give the credit to the Reserve Bank that it was the first institution in the country which actually ushered in the era of using of digital signature certificates in large numbers. And then subsequently, of course, the government followed in 2005 with multiple e-governance applications. Now, we have been using for last 12, 14 years these digital signature certificates. Then the number of applications use these certificates, also the number of applications are getting migrated for their proper use using the digital signature certificates. One such example is the UI Kuber application of the Reserve Bank, which is actually a CBS of the central bank, which was the subsequent transition to the digital signature certificate. However, there are certain applications which still do not use the digital signature certificate, and these are the places where we can look at as opportunities. So the banks, CBS, today also it uses the user ID password, and I don't know, any of you have, those who are not from banks. Banks also use fingerprints. For example, if any of you have taken a housing loan, and when you go to the processing centers of the banks, you may have observed that in addition to the user ID and password, some of the banks have implemented biometric. So the officer has to use his biometric. But unfortunately, still we have not come to a stage wherein the digital certificates can be used. And this is where we can look forward, how we can implement that. Other area is the customer-initiated transactions. Many banks have gone ahead and implemented PKI, at least for the corporate customers. And the other area where we can really expand the use is where the customer-initiated transactions. In the invited talk by Professor Shivakumar, he was mentioning that mobile is the device of the future. So if we can have digital signature certificates operating from a mobile, maybe compatible with the Android, iOS, and other such platforms, that will go a long way in having expansion of digital signature certificates from the organized sector to the retail. If you look at applications, what are there today, any application you take, these are all mandated either by the government or by the regulator, where the digital signature certificates are getting used in the large scale. But if we want to look at the opportunities in terms of explosion in numbers, we have to look at the retail level, where the individuals will be able to use this with the ease, which there are challenges we'll subsequently look at. The other applications are banks can implement for the internal applications. They may can use it even for the email application, which can be converted as a process flow application for decision making, where the signatures are required and like that. Now, so the opportunities are many, but what is hindering the progress and what certifying authorities and the office of CC also is looking during the last few years is how to surmount the challenges which are actually not helping the increase in the digital signature certificate penetration. The most important is the ease of use. And because of the security considerations, the regulators are forced to put certain restrictions on the way a certificate is to be used. And that at times the individuals may find it difficult. So we need to find a way wherein, without compromising on security, whether we can increase the ease. Many of the my friends here who are from banks will understand, even those who are from the government sector will understand that at times it becomes difficult and cumbersome to make use of digital certificates. There are a lot of compatibility issues. Whenever the version change happens, the applications don't work. So that is the challenge. The crypto token issue has been discussed many times, and I understand there will be some sessions wherein we will be able to look at how we can make it not only is easy in terms of use, but also the way the licensing policy works. I do not know how many of you are aware. Earlier, the crypto tokens used to be sold on a token, but today the model that has been changed by the vendors is they are charging for use as a license fee. The way something similar to what happens in case of Oracle. When you buy Oracle, you initially pay some amount, and then subsequently for every time you are using, every year you have to pay some amount of license fee. So it has to be something. When you are looking at institutions and the government sector, the costs are taken care of by the organizations. But when you want to increase the usage for the retail segment, we need to look at the cost. And if there are certain costs which we cannot shun away, then we have to find a model wherein the institutions which are actually making use of it should share some of the costs which is to be paid by the retail user. Another point is the legal awareness in the general public about the digital signature. Many of the people do not know that a digital signature is as critical as your checkbook, which if it goes in somebody's hand and he is able to put a paper signature, you may lose money. So that is another aspect that needs to be addressed. A key compromise is something like you have lost the key or somebody has stolen it, and then in such case actually the somebody else will be able to impersonate you, and he will act as if he is, he will claim to be what you are, and there is no way you can say that you are not. And there are certain sections in the IT Act which makes it difficult for a person whose key has been compromised to save himself. In a sense, if you look at the Indian legal system, general Indian penal code and all, the courts will pronounce somebody as guilty unless you prove he is guilty. Unless he is proven guilty, he is innocent. But in case of the IT Act, if I have my digital signature certificate, I have my private keys, and if I am not able to prove that somebody else has stolen my keys, I will be considered as guilty. So it's exactly opposite. In a normal legal system, unless proven guilty, the person is innocent. But in case of digital signature certificate, unless the owner proves that somebody has taken the key, it is presumed that he has signed. So if he has signed, what are the consequences in terms of loss of money or loss of assets, or depending on the requirement of the workflow where he is using the signature, it will be that much more difficult. So this part of the way that the signature and key is important needs to be told to the individual users. Today, unfortunately, what is happening is, because of the regulatory requirements or the government requirements, people are, or the organizations are taking the digital certificates, but they are not knowing to what extent that is very important. The last point is the cost. This cost is not of the certificate. Certificate cost is only one part of the cost. The cost of the complete life cycle in terms of its use, its storage, and its proper destruction so that it is not misused. So this is one aspect which actually when we start using, then only we start realizing how, and those are the points which we need to address to ensure that we are able to spread the digital certificate usage. Now I want to tell something which is, it is not done today possibly, but maybe we have to look at, and that could be the future. One way we can use is how we can reduce the cost. Today, the banks have their customers. For that purpose, the banks do a lot of know your customer guidelines are there. They are much more, they're quite rigorous, something similar to you get for a digital certificate or for a passport, wherein the banks need to verify the identity, you need to verify their address. Now, if banks are able to do this work and the certifying authorities collaborate with banks and take care of the technology part, then the cost, incremental cost of issue of digital certificate will drastically come down. The life cycle cost also will come down because he's the bank's customer, and in any case, the in terms of its reuse, in terms of its renewal will be that much more easier. If the cost is shared between the bank and the certifying authority and the customer starts using it, the benefits that we'll get will be, one is the cost has reduced. The second point is the banks will be able to benefit from it. So many of the bankers, I would like to tell them here, today there are many online frauds happening. Whenever online frauds happen, typically it is a compromise of a user ID or a password, or sometimes it is even spoofing of the mobile SIM. There have been number of cases wherein the those who wanted to steal, they went to a telecom service provider, and possibly the agent through whom they got the SIM was compromised, and they got a duplicate SIM, and using that they activated it, and they were able to use the OTP on the duplicate SIM, and that is how the money was taken away. Now, if you look at all these cases, some of them went to court, and in many of these cases, the banks were the losers. Actually, banks had not done, they had done all the correct process. They had taken undertaking from the customer that he will take care of his user ID password. But in such cases, the onus was on the banks, not on the customer. That customer may have been negligent in disclosing his user ID password and possibly not acting fast enough if he found that his mobile or the SIM was compromised. If banks, now what I'm telling is how it is going to help the banks in going for this type of asking customers to take these digital signatures will help the banks in protecting themselves. As I told earlier, if the customer has been given a digital signature certificate, then the customer will be the one who has to prove that he has, his key has been compromised. Unless he is able to prove that, the onus will be on the customer. So banks, if they implement digital signature certificates, will be doing a safer banking, and by educating the customer properly, banks will not be unnecessary at a loss for mistakes which are not committed by them, it is committed by somebody else. Now, this is what can be done in the existing environment, what I told. Already the digital signature certificate framework is already is in place. If the banks can collaborate with the certifying authorities, this is possible. Now, what I'm telling further is something which we can look at in future. And as far as technology is concerned, this technology is there since 2002, 2003. Number of research papers are there, even successful implementations are there. This is something called as signature without certificate or certificateless signature. In this, the way it works is the customer trusts the bank. Since the customer is trusting the bank, partial keys can be generated by the banks, given to the customers, and the customers can then sign. These signatures can be verified at the banks. Technically, this will work. Today, we do not have the legal confirmation of this, and for that we will have to possibly look forward in next few years. Maybe we can look at how this can be implemented, it can be done. But technology wise it is possible, and if you look at the business model as a customer trusting the bank, it will very much is already in place. The other advantage of this is it will cost much less because it just deals with the customers, with the bank. And it need not be only banks and customers. Tomorrow, for example, income tax department is there. Income tax department is the central authority, and the taxpayers are the ones who trust the income tax department. If the government department is the central authority and the all the companies who file, they are actually the ones who will be able to give. Of course, this solution does not have any role for the certifying authorities, but as a technology, we need to forward, and if some technology is a destructive technology, we should look at whether it is useful. Maybe the multiple models can coexist, and whichever is the best model can be allowed to grow. So this is what I wanted to say. If there are some questions, I will take. Thank you.